Okay, I'm not a statistician, so I'm scared, but okay, let's look. So this is joint research with Anatoly Yuditsky from University of Grenoble in France, and the title is Statistical Inferences via Convex Optimization. And okay, no, everybody knows that optimization plays some role in statistics. So for example, in maximum likelihood estimation, you need to maximize something. But this maximum likelihood estimation uses statistics only for number crunching. The procedure itself and its performance analysis has nothing in common with optimization. Okay, what you need is the algorithm, which allows you to maximize something. And there are many traditional applications of optimization and statistics, to the best of my understanding, how this number crunching type. What will be in this talk is something different. Optimization is not just algorithms. There is also same convex optimization, which I'll speak about. There is duality, rich duality theory, there is convex analysis. And what I'll try to present are some situations where the statistical inferences themselves are motivated and justified by convex optimization. Okay, so the first, there will be two parts. One is the detector-based hypothesis testing, and the second will be signal recovery. So we will start with this detector-based hypothesis testing. So we are looking at very basic problem. You have two families of probability distributions on some observation space. You observe realization, have an observation which is distributed according to distribution which either belongs to P1 or to P2, and you want to decide on two hypotheses. So the first says that distribution underlying your observation belongs to P1, and the second that belongs to P2. You could associate with those two families of distributions a detector. What is a detector? It's just a real-valued function on your observation space. And you can specify the risks of this detector. So there are two risks. The first risk, you take exponent of minus phi, take its expectation with respect to distribution for the first family, and then maximize over those distributions from the first family, you get a number. And the second, you take e to the power phi, and take expectation with respect to distribution for the second family, and maximize over distributions from the second family. No, and the, just the, so you can immediately see that you have this equality. Now, if you are given a detector, you can associate with the test, which accepts the first hypothesis when phi of omega, your observation omega is such that, if you don't mind, I'll see it. It's okay? When phi of omega is non-negative, otherwise you accept the second hypothesis. Now, immediate observation is that those partial risks of our test, so the first risk is to the probability, the worst case of a distribution from H1, to reject hypothesis H1, okay? And the second is the worst case probability, the worst case of distributions from H2, to reject the hypothesis H2, okay, they are bounded by risks of this detector. No, and okay, the reason is absolutely trivial. Okay, well, when you reject the first, I assume that the first hypothesis is true, and when you reject it, when phi of omega is non-positive, phi of omega is non-positive, this exponent is greater than or equal than one, it is non-negative, so that this integral is upper bound on the probability to reject the first hypothesis when it is true. No, and similarly for this guy. It's absolutely trivial statement. Now, what do those detectors admit? A simple calculus. Now, first of all, if you shift a detector by a constant, this is what happens with risks. The first risk is multiplied by the exponent of that shift, and the second is divided by the exponent. So the bottom line, what consequence is that what matters are not those two risks, the first and the second, but their product. Given this product, you can, by shifting your detector, you can redistribute the risks as you want. Okay, in particular, you always can make your detector balanced, and both risks are equal to each other. Now, this detector-based test are ideally well suited to passing from single observation to multiple observations. So assume you have a sequence of pair families of hypotheses, okay, indexed by k. And for every k, you have detector for the corresponding for p1k and p2k. Okay, now you can look at product distributions. So distributions of you, now you have k capital observations, which are drawn independently of each other from some distributions. And one hypothesis says that all those distributions are taken from the families p1k, and the second that they are taken from families p2k. And you can assemble your detectors into this very simple way, but just summing up. In the separable way, you can, what happens if, I'm afraid this thing is dead. Okay. Okay, no, at least it is something. Okay, so what happens with the risks when you pass from single observation to multiple? They just are multiplied by each other. Okay, they are, thank you. That is very simple way to understand what happens with the risks when you pass to multiple observations. Okay, now I'm supposed to use two things. Now we can pass from pairwise detectors to detectors for pairwise detector-based tests to tests for multiple hypotheses. So let's look at the following situation. You have several families of distributions, finitely many of them, R capital. They are called red families. And you have B capital, again, finitely many, brown families of distributions, everything on the same space. Now, you have pairwise detectors. So you take a red family and a blue family, a brown family, and you assume that you have balanced detector for those two particular red and brown families. No, and they have certain risks. Now what we want, we are given observation which is drawn from distribution which either belongs to the union of red distribution families or belongs to the union of brown families. And we want to decide what is the color of the distribution, where what we observe comes from this family of distributions or belongs to this family of distributions. No, okay, what the recipe is, build rectangular matrix from those risks, okay, those risks, pairwise risks of your detectors. No, okay, let me, that doesn't matter what is exactly written. In formulas, let me say 10 words what's going on. So you take the spectral norm of this matrix, and it turns out that you can assemble your pairwise detectors into a single detector such that the risk of the corresponding detector when you, okay, on those unions of red and brown families is at most the spectral norm of this matrix. Okay. Now, more interesting situation of multiple testing, in my opinion, is testing up to closeness. So imagine you have L families of probability distributions on the same space. So you have this observation, you want to decide on L capital hypothesis. So L hypothesis says that the distribution underlying your observation belongs to L family. So ideal goal would be to decide what is the hypothesis which is true. But it could be impossible because, say, I didn't say that those families of distributions they can intersect. And in this situation, you cannot decide reliably of what you observe. Вот так, to which family belongs the distribution of your observation. Okay, but if we cannot identify the distribution, doesn't mean that we cannot say something reasonable about this distribution. No, and here is example. Imagine that what we are observing is Gaussian two-dimensional vector. The mean we do not know. The noisy part of this Gaussian random vector. We know it is standard Gaussian zero mean vector. And what we know about the mean, the hypothesis, say every one of them says something about the mean. So we have three hypotheses. The first says that the mean is in this brown rectangle. The second that it is in green rectangle. And the third is that it is in the blue rectangle. Now clearly you cannot identify whatever small the noise is, you cannot identify the color of your signal because, say, you know, those two, brown and green, they intersect. But perhaps you can say something, perhaps you can eliminate some options given your observation. For example, imagine that the true signal is brown, you don't know it. But okay, if it is brown, then I definitely cannot guarantee that you will not say that it is green. Because again, brown and green intersect. But perhaps you can guarantee, if the noise is small enough, that it is not blue. And that is better than nothing. Okay, so how could we capture this situation? And you can make partial inference, not exactly identifying the true hypothesis. It's called testing up to closeness. So you have L capital hypothesis. And you have a closeness relation C. It is just a set of pairs of indices of those hypotheses. Okay, and we interpret the fact that the pair of indices L and L prime is in the C capital. It means that hypothesis HL and HL prime are close to each other. Okay. For example, in the previous transparency, okay, we could say that 1 and 2 are close to each other, 2 and 3 are close to each other, but say we not necessarily should say that 1 and 3 are close to each other. Okay, so what we require from this closeness, it could be whatever it want, but we require just two things. Every hypothesis is close to itself, so the C capital contains diagonal pairs L with two equal entries, and it is also very convenient to assume that the closeness is symmetric. If pair L, L prime belongs to C, that so is the pair L prime L. Okay. Now imagine that you have system of balanced detectors, okay, for all those pairs. It makes sense to assume that the detectors are skew symmetric in the indices. And those are wreaths of those detectors. It makes sense to assume that the wreaths are symmetric in the indices. Okay, so that this is what we have. Collection of functions of observation phi L L prime with this property and symmetric in indices epsilon such that you have this inequality. Okay, you take expectation of minus detector, take the supremum over distributions from the L, the first index, from the L family, and that this should be less than or equal to what you see here. So what does it mean, a test with C risk of at most epsilon? It means the following. A test which takes your observation, it is allowed to accept several hypotheses, for example, none of them, or all of them. But what we want, what does it mean that C risk is less than or equal to epsilon? It means that if L star corresponds to a true hypothesis, index of the true hypothesis, then probability of the following await. First, this true hypothesis will be accepted. And second, all accepted hypotheses will be close to it in this. Is at most 1 minus epsilon. So for this picture, it would mean that the test, which accepts several, given observation, accepts several of those hypotheses, but the probability of the event, for example, that the true signal is brown, okay, and Okay, in this situation, the true signal is brown. The probability of the event, brown hypothesis will be accepted, and blue will not. So all accepted hypotheses will include the true one and all close to it. And close to it is only the green one. Okay, the probability of this event is 1 minus epsilon. Then the result is like this again, that you can build matrix, now symmetric matrix, so you take those risks of your pairwise detectors, and make them entries in the matrix, but only for those pairs L and L prime which are not close to each other. When L and L prime are close to each other, you write zero entry in the matrix. This matrix has a spectral norm. Okay, and it turns out that you can assemble your pairwise detectors in detector with C risk. Okay, at most the spectral norm of this matrix. Now, for example, if the risks corresponding to distant from each other hypotheses, not close to each other, all of them are less than one, and you are allowed for stationary k-repeat observation, you can repeat your observation, okay? Then, you can build a test, okay, for which its C risk is bounded by this, okay, so theta to the power of k, so the more observations exponentially goes to zero, and L is times the number of hypotheses. Okay. Now, those detector-based tests, of course, you can represent whatever test via say, okay, it accepts the first, not this deterministic, it pairwise test, it accepts the first hypothesis. If it accepts the first hypothesis, phi is positive, otherwise phi is negative. But the risk in general of this detector, of the test, will have nothing in common with the risk of the corresponding detector. So we not only are saying that we are speaking about pairwise detectors, pairwise tests which are given by detectors. This is not restriction at all. We are measuring the quantifying upper bounding the risk in certain special way. Okay, and turns out that it's more or less universal approach because if you have two hypotheses, which by in the nature there exist tests which decides on them with risk at most less than 1/2. Then you can find detector-based test, with risk, let's say, comparable to this epsilon. The risk of this detector will be like twice square root of epsilon. This is less than one. You can say, okay, when you have risk epsilon and here you have like square root of epsilon, it's much, much worse. But if you are allowed by for multiple observations, then we remember that like four times squared this, okay, if you have four repeated observations, you should take this risk and take it to the power of four when you are speaking about detector-based tests. No, you will recover your epsilon. Okay. Now, so the bottom line, I would say, is that if we were able to find good detectors, it would be worthy of effort to try to find. Now, what is the best possible detector? It's a solution to this optimization problem. So we want to this is the definition of risk, again, for pair of hypotheses, for pair of distributions. So this problem, of minimizing the risk over phi, formally is a convex problem, because, what is written here, it's convex in phi inequality, and this also convex in phi inequality. Okay, we also have additional stuff. If you replace those families by their convex hulls, you do not change the risk, because the inequalities you want to solve, those constraints are linear in P, in the distribution. Okay, so it is nice convex problem, but the only difficulty is that it is infinite dimensional problem. Phi is infinite dimensional. We have no idea how to represent it in computer. And it is also a problem with infinitely many constraints. Constraints are parameterized by distributions from a family. So even if I give you a phi, we don't know how to compute the risk. So there are simple observation schemes, well-defined notion. where you can solve this problem. And this is the next thing I'm going to speak about. So that those simple observation schemes meet formal definition, which I'll skip to save time. Let's look at examples. Gaussian observation scheme. So your observation is you take a signal x, which varies somewhere in certain Rn. You take a affine image under given affine mapping and add standard Gaussian noise. Okay? So this is the standard observation model on signal processing. And this is a good observation, a simple observation scheme. Another scheme, this is Poisson. So your observation is integer vector with independent entries. And those entries are Poisson random variables. Parameters of those Poisson distributions are affinely parametrized by some signal, which again lives somewhere. Okay. No, we assume that the signal lives in an open convex signal space, no, and such that those parameters of the Poisson distribution on X is in this script X, they are positive. So this is what arises in Poisson emission tomography, in large binocular telescope and nanoscale fluorescent microscopy. Now, discrete optimization scheme. You're speaking about distribution of random variable, which takes d capital, small d values. It is convenient for me to represent those values as basic ords in Rd. Okay, so I could say that the variable takes values 1 to 3 and so on d. I could encode those 1 to 3 and so on d by basic ords in Rd. No, and the probabilities to to take value E1 and so on ED, they are finely parameterized by again a signal which lives in some open convex space. Now those are three basic simple observation schemes. Again, this notion has a formal definition, but those are the most important examples. And there is also the following thing. You have several simple observation schemes, you take their direct product. You look at k observations, the first stems from the second first scheme, the second from the second scheme, and so on, and they are independent across the indices. This again will be a simple observation scheme. Now, all those distributions from simple observation scheme, they possess positive densities with respect to properly selected reference measure. And let me, we will speak about convex hypothesis in simple observation scheme. Look, every time in all those simple observation schemes, you have signal which underlies your observation. And signal lives in a convex set, open convex set, the script X. Convex hypothesis is as follows. You take a compact convex subset in the script X and say, my hypothesis is that the signal underlying my observation belongs to this capital X. Okay, this I'll call convex hypothesis. If you want this hypothesis on the parameter of distribution, that the parameter of distribution belongs to convex set, convex compact set. Now, main result is like this. If you are given two convex hypotheses in a simple observation scheme, then this problem of identifying the optimal detector is can be reduced to explicitly given finite dimensional convex optimization problem. This is how this problem. No, okay, this is what the problem is. Okay, you should minimize Hellinger affinity between the distributions from the families. Not minimize, maximize the Hellinger affinity. And it turns out for the simple observation scheme, this is an explicit convex optimization problem. You can solve it efficiently. Okay, and the problem is solvable. If you take a solution, it defines you some detector, which is just like the likelihood detector for those two distributions. Okay, and it turns out that this is the optimal. Okay, this is this phi star is optimal solution to this infinite dimensional semi-infinite problem, and optimal value exponent of the optimal value in this problem is the risk, is the epsilon. No, here, how those problems look in the situation of those three basic schemes. So in the Gaussian observation scheme, you should all you need is to find two closest and the Euclidean norm. That this is to what this problem boils down. Okay, in the Poisson observation scheme, this is to what the problem boils down, that this one. Then the discrete observation scheme, this is to what the problem boils down. All those are convex optimization problems, you see explicit. If you have k-repeated version, you can find the optimal k-repeated version of an observation scheme. The optimal solution to the k-repeated observation, simple observation scheme, the optimal detector, is just very easily, can be obtained very easily from the solution to a single observation situation. Now, those tests based on minimal risk detectors in simple observation scheme possess several optimality properties. The first say that if you have two convex hypotheses, and in the nature there exists single observation test which decides on those two hypotheses, at most epsilon, which is epsilon is less than 1/2, then there is also that this optimal detector-based risk, the one which we can compute explicitly, okay, it has comparable risk. Now, if you are allowed to multi for repeated observations, the situation is even better. Okay, so you have for some k star in the nature there exists a test which decides via k star repeated observation on your two convex hypotheses within risk epsilon. Now then, this is something which exists in the nature. We have no idea what it is, but this test which we can build explicitly, stemming from the minimum risk test. It will get the same accurate risk epsilon when the number of observations is not k star, but it is at least some not okay. So, for small epsilon, 2k star already will be okay. No, and similarly for this risk, for testing multiple hypotheses up to C risk. No, okay, here again, if in the nature there exist k-repeated observation seconds allowed, there exists k-star, a test in the nature which decides in risk epsilon via k-star observations, and okay, we increase the number of observations by this factor, and you see that the number of hypotheses we are deciding upon is under log here. Okay, okay, so again, this tends to this. Okay, all this factor tends to 2 as epsilon goes to 0. Okay, so you'll roughly speaking twice increase the number of observations, and all what you can compute all will work not worse than what you have in the nature. Now, what are generic applications of this? Those which are already known. Okay, so you can build near optimal estimates of linear fractional linear functionals on finite unions of convex sets. Okay, it's known how to recover linear functionals. That there is a very nice theorem of Donahoe of 1994, I believe. Says that the optimal linear estimate, which is easy to compute, it allows to, in the Gaussian observation scheme, is near optimal up to factor 1.2 when you are recovering linear function. Okay, here on a convex compact set, signal belongs to a given convex compact set. Now we allow for finite unions of convex sets. And also the objective, what you are estimating could be linear fractional. Now there is sequential testing of convex hypotheses, change point detection, and rudimentary measurement design. I'll only give you an outline of the very first point here, because this is easy. It doesn't take much time. So this is the situation. You have a signal X, you observe it via simple observation scheme. You know that it belongs to union of M given to you convex compact sets. And this is what you want to recover from observation. fractional linear function. We know in advance that denominator is positive on the set, so that there are no singularities. Okay, so how could we do it? Well, let's do the following. So those blue sets are my X capital 1, X capital 2, and so on. Now, why fractional linear, not something else? Because for fractional linear function, the set of arguments where it is in between two bounds is convex. Okay. For fractional linear function, if you impose upper and lower bounds on this function, look where it is in between those bounds, it will be a convex set. So we take the range of our function which you want to recover, split it in n capital equal segments of equal length, okay, and define convex hypothesis. Okay, so what are they? You take your capital X's, so and intersect with okay, for every new, you take the set where f of x takes value in newth bin delta nu, and intersect it with all your x mu. So you take those blue sets, which are your x capital mu. Now that those stripes here are where the function is in between. No, okay, that this is where it belongs to the first segment. Here is the when it belongs to the second segment. So you end up with at most m capital, m capital, m capital is how many bins you have, m capital, how many corners x capital you have. You end up with finitely many convex hypotheses on your signal. You define closeness, okay, you say that the two hypotheses are closed, so that if or they come from the same stripe or from two neighboring stripes. You apply this machinery to build detector which decides on those hypotheses up to closeness, and then you say, okay, I'll take as estimate of my functional, I take all the accepted stripes and take the center of masses of the corresponding segments delta I. And this is the result. If in the nature you can, delta n is the width of the length of your bins. If in the nature there exists a test which with accuracy delta n divided by 2, and which uses K-star observations, then you will get twice worse accuracy, delta n and null delta n over 2, if the number of observations, again, is by logarithmic factor greater than what ideal in the nature. Okay, so common denominator of those results is that detectors which we use in simple observation schemes, they are affine functions of observations. And now you can say, okay, let's try to look at what we can get with affine in observations detectors if we are beyond the scope of observation schemes. And this is what you can do. So imagine you are given three entities, convex symmetric set script H in some RD. RD is your observation space. Convex parameter set script M and the function phi, which is convex concave function of H and mu. So given those three entities, you can define a set of distributions of omega. What are those distributions? You look at, take a distribution, look at this, how it is called, logarithmic distance generating function. Okay, that is written here. You restrict the H to reside in this script H. And you say, okay, distribution is good for me if there exists parameter mu from the script mu, such that for all h's from the script h, this logarithmic moment generating function is upper bounded by this phi. So again, phi belongs to the family, that this is the family which I'm going to define, if there exists mu such that for all h's from script h, the summing relation holds true. So mu will refer to it as parameter of distribution p. Now the distribution may have many different parameters. So I'll speak about this triple is about simple data, is about regular data and this family of distributions, which is covered, satisfying this definition. It's called simple family of distributions induced by data. You can immediately see that Gaussian and sub-Gaussian distributions are in this family, and the corresponding function phi is just as you see. The parameter is expectation and, in the Gaussian case, covariance matrix. In sub-Gaussian case, what's the matrix parameter in sub-Gaussian, this is the function. It's linear in U and linear in H and quadratic, linear in mu, mu is U and theta. So mu is expectation and covariance, the parameter. And H is whatever vector, so it is clearly, covariance is restricted to be positive semi-definite. Then this is indeed function which is convex in H and linear and consequently concave in mu. Not that for Poisson distribution you have the same, that discrete distributions are covered by this scheme. Distributions with bounded support can be covered by this scheme. We properly select those three. H, M, and phi. Now it turns out that if you are given two families of simple distributions, so H1, mu1, and M1, and phi1 are parameters defining, are data defining the first family, and when, H2, M2, and phi2 define the second family, and now you won't decide on those two families. You want to find the detector. And it turns out that you generate a saddle point, write down explicitly a convex concave saddle point problem. It is and the solution to this problem, this H capital gives you a fine detector, and you know what is the risk of the detector on those two families. And the best you can get stems from the saddle point problem. The point is that you can reduce finding the best allowed for by our assumption a fine detector to solving the saddle point efficiently computable problem. Let me skip those examples. I believe that those transparencies will be available. What we can capture is compared, let's speak about sub-Gaussian case and Gaussian case. What we can capture, which we cannot capture with simple observation scheme. We can allow for dependence, imagine you observe Gaussian realization of Gaussian distribution that has covariance matrix and expectation. Before we were considering situation, the expectation runs through a convex set and covariance is just fixed once forever. Now you will say expectation and covariance run through a convex set. So you can allow that this is what specifies the family of distributions. So you can allow for some dependencies between expectation and covariance. What I was just telling works when you are trying to find the fine detectors. But what is a fine detector? Fine an observations. And what is observation? It's to some extent our business. For example, you have observation zeta, which comes from family, from distribution P. You can say that let's look at the following. Let's augment this observation by the matrix of products of entries in zeta. Let's say this is our observation. If you observe zeta, you definitely observe this omega. But now what is affine in omega is in fact quadratic in zeta. So you can use this technique for building good affine detectors to build quadratic detectors also. The only bottleneck is that you should be able to you pass from your original observation, true observation zeta, to its quadratic lifting. Now you should cover the distributions of those liftings by something by regular date. Okay, this could be done in Gaussian and sub-Gaussian case, and let's look at the example, illustration, very briefly. So what you see here is kind of movie, okay? So you see frames, perhaps, at least perhaps many of them know who is this person, and definitely everybody has seen this picture. Okay, and you see, okay, so time, so we pass from frame to frame. No, one picture starts to change, and you start with this, you end with this. So the question is, where the change starts? No, what is your opinion? Okay, now I believe I have enough time to that's what, in my opinion, is the most interesting here, is as far as links of optimization and statistics are concerned, as I understand. So this very classical statistical problem. We have Gaussian observation scheme, so there is a signal X. You multiply it by a given matrix, you add standard Gaussian noise. You know that the signal runs through a given convex compact set, script X. You don't know what the signal is, but you know where it lives. Okay, and you want to recover image. No, okay, the standard problem is to recover X itself. We will try to recover image of this X under multiplication by a given matrix. And we are interested in L2 risk. So you, what you take? You take candidate estimate, plug X hat off. Okay, you plug your observation in this estimate, you get a vector of dimension where K, where the B lives. Subtracting from Bx, you take squared Euclidean norm, take expectation, now it depends, given the estimate, it depends on the true signal, you take supremum over all signals from your signal space, script X. Okay, and take squared, okay, that you call this risk of estimate X hat on this X script. So what we are about to do? We are about to do that you, under appropriate assumptions on this X capital, you can, in a computationally efficient way, build a nearly optimal linear estimate. Now, linear estimate is estimate of this type. You could, in principle, add also constant term, but in my setup of this X capital always will be symmetric with respect to the origin. So the constant term doesn't help. Okay? You indeed need the linear estimate at non-affine. So this is one thing, and second thing, very surprising, is that this nearly best among linear estimates is turns out to be nearly optimal among all estimates. Now, so let's look. First of all, what we assume about the noise, that's zero mean with unit covariance matrix. Now, you can immediately write down under this assumption what is the risk of a candidate linear estimate. And the squared risk is what you see here, and what you see here, okay, this is something which we understand. This is what comes from the noise passing through your linear estimate, squared Euclidean norm of this noisy component. And this is the bias, squared bias, okay, of your estimate. It depends on the true signal X, and it depends on your candidate estimate on this matrix H capital. Now, you should take maximum of this quadratic form of small x, so x is from x capital. No, and this will be the squared bias of your estimate. The worst case squared bias. So this is what if we were looking for the best linear estimate, what we were supposed to take this function and to optimize it with respect to h. No, and the immediate difficulty is that, okay, this we understand how to compute, but this what this psi capital of H is maximum of quadratic form of small x. It depends on H as a parameter, it doesn't matter. But you should maximize quadratic form of small x over your set script x. And typically maximizing on this convex quadratic form, maximizing of convex quadratic form over a convex set is a difficult problem, could be NP-hard. Okay, so this function psi, it is convex, it's fine, but it doesn't help because it is typically not efficiently computable. So when it is efficiently computable, no, in the situation when your script X is either convex hull of finitely many points is given by scenarios which is not interesting, or is ellipsoid. It's again the situation and you can compute exactly this. But if this your signal set is as simple as the standard unit box, okay, then already computing what is written here is in p-hat. So what we go to do, we go to the, we are going to to find an upper efficiently computable upper bound on this psi. And to replace the, in the problem of synthesis of the best linear estimate, the true function psi with this upper bound. So what I'm trying to say is that unless your signal space is an ellipsoid, even finding the best among linear estimates is computationally, could be computationally difficult problem. But we will try to do something about it. So, and whether we can do something or cannot, it depends on what the script is, yes, what is your universe, the signal space. We will consider very special situation, not very, okay, you can say special, you can say general. It's called an elitope. So what is it? Let's look at the set here. Okay. You have bunch of K capital positive semi-definite matrices. You write down quadratic inequality with the right-hand side, which is variable on y. And you say, okay, let's look at all y's which satisfy those inequalities for some t from a given set, script t. Okay, so those y's such that there exist, okay, you take solution set to the system of quadratic, convex quadratic inequalities in variables y and t, and then project it onto the y space. This gives you something, and then you further project it, take linear image of the set under some mapping. You will get something. Okay, so again, you take specific system of quadratic, convex quadratic inequalities in variables y and t, take the solution set, project it onto the y space, and then project it, map it onto the x space. You will get some set x, script x. We require the set to be bounded. It is called an elitope. Okay, what you require from this script t, it should be convex compact set. Okay, in non-negative order, no, okay, for this inequality, Sk is positive semi-definite, so for this inequality to take, to make sense, Tk should be non-negative. And you assume that, that this set contains a strictly positive vector, and what is written here, it is for free, that the set is monotone. Okay, that is not restrictive, that whenever you have a point from the set, you decrease its entries, but keep them positive, the reduced point also will be this in this t. Okay, every elitope is convex compact set symmetric with respect to the origin. Examples include intersection of finitely many elliptic cylinders, intersection of finitely many, let's say, LP balls of cylinders where p is between 2 and infinity. Now you can extend it by much wider family of sets to what follows, but let's stick to what we have. What is nice is that those sets admit fully algorithmic calculus. The set of those elitopes is closed with respect to all basic operations, which preserve convexity and symmetry with respect to the origin. So let's say what is built in these elitopes is symmetry with respect to the origin and convexity. No, what are those operations? So intersection of finitely many elitopes is an elitope. Direct product is an elitope. Convex hull of finite union. Arithmetic sum, linear images, inverse linear images. So that this is not everything we would like to get. You cannot get the standard simplex in this way. It's not symmetric. Okay, but this is pretty, indeed wide family of sets. Now, it turns out that you given a quadratic function on this elitope, you can efficiently upper bound it. So what you are doing, I want to, I have quadratic form, why we are interested in, because this, the bias of candidate linear estimate to compute to upper bounded, we need to maximize quadratic form over x capital. So and here is how could you upper bound this maximum. So you have quadratic form. You look at this, not the script less than or equal to, is matrix less than or equal to. So that this difference of right-hand side and left-hand side is positive semi-definite. Okay, lambda sum on negative variables. So every you take solution, every lambda which satisfies this. No, and then you have upper bound on your quadratic form. So you take this set script T which participates in description of your X capital. You take its support function phi T of lambda, you get an efficiently computable convex function. No, and you see that, okay, and that this is what is written at this convex constraint on lambdas, that this convex function of lambda upper bounds the maximum you are interested in. And the immediate conclusion is that let's look at this convex optimization problem, which you see here, explicit convex optimization problem. Okay, in variables lambda and h. It is solvable. It's, you can compute efficiently its solution. And if you take the h component of this solution and you use it in your linear estimate, okay, it produces a linear estimate. This is how you can, risk of the resulting estimate is at most the square root of all. So this is safe, this problem is safe approximation of the problem of building the best linear estimate. And this reasonably tight approximation, because if you are interested in the best linear estimate, then this is what the problem you want to solve. You want to minimize the true risk, okay, and not its upper bound. Now it turns out that the estimate you end up to this logarithmic in k, k is the number of quadratic inequalities participating in the description of x. Okay, it's up to this logarithmic term optimum. So we cannot, in general, find the best, even the best among the linear estimates, but we can find something which is nearly optimal. And extremely strange fact is that this which even among linear estimates not exactly optimal, is nearly optimal among all estimates, and here is the answer. So you are given this L-top, you associate it with a theta constant. It doesn't matter for me now how they are defined. Okay, you look this at this problem of building the best, no, okay, nearly the best, that what we get, the tractable version, tractable safe approximation of problem of building the best linear estimate. Okay, and it turns out that the resulting linear estimate is nearly optimal as compared to in the family of all estimates. So this is the bound you can write down on the risk of this estimate. So risk of, the risk of is the optimal risk with respect to taking over all possible estimates, linear and non-linear. And you see that our, okay, it's now not optimal up to constant factor, but it's optimal up to something which is logarithmic in the true quantity. Ну, to say what is going on here, first we should definitely we know that the linear estimate is not, cannot be optimal typically. And that is so even in the situation when you are recovering the average, the mean of Gaussian number, and you know that this mean lives in a segment. But we know that in this situation the best linear estimate is optimal with factor 1.2. But what is the optimal estimate? Definitely is nonlinear, and we don't actually know what is it. So this is very strange result, I would say, and let me comment, let me try to understand, to explain why, fine, I understand. I have two transparencies now. So where the strange result comes from? What is surprising here? It is completely independent of what are the matrices A and B. If you look at classical results of non-parametric statistics on when the linear estimates are nearly optimal, then all of them, or they assume that you have direct observations. A is the unit matrix, is B in the unit matrix. Or at the most very how to say, the widest case when you can claim something about optimality, and what you are claiming in traditional statistics is just you compute everything. Okay. Here we do not compute. I don't know what the risks are. I'm just saying that they are more or less the same up to logarithmic factor. So this is the situation when your A and B are diagonal and your X is like the ellipsoid with X is given by diagonal matrix. Okay, so this is our problem which is responsible for nearly optimal linear estimate. Sorry. Let's look at this problem, which is okay. The objective here is what you see here. It is, so the problem is like this. You look at Gaussian distribution, the Q is covariance matrix of this distribution. And this is distribution of eta. You now say eta and xi are independent Gaussian. Okay, xi is standard and eta has like this. And now given A eta plus sigma xi, I want to recover B eta, and I want the expectation taken, so this is a Bayesian risk what we are speaking about. I try to look for minimal expectation taken with respect to both eta, h and psi, expected squared recovery error. Okay, so this is we know that if you have a Gaussian vector and recovering one component through another component, that is the optimal estimate is linear. Okay, so this problem, now constraints, so the objective is like Bayesian risk associated with prior, which is given by Q, and we are playing with this prior. Constraints here, they are responsible for the fact, for small rho, that nearly all probability mass of the set sits in our S capital. Okay, so you can lower bound the optimal risk in terms of this Bayesian risk, yeah, in terms of this optimal value of rho. This is more or less easy. So which also easy, but it is a miracle. It turns out that when rho is equal to 1, this quantity is exactly the optimal risk of this linear estimate, what is responsible for linear estimate. Why it is so, I don't know, but I know that you look at this problem, you take set rho equal to 1, you compute the conic dual of this problem, and you end up with problem of building optimal linear estimate. So this is this. Thank you. That's it.